Brother, are you saved? I don't know about you, but when that comes to me, I squirm a bit. I kind of head for cover. I fear a confrontation, possibly a long sermon, and then I have this very, very aching feeling that someone might be just as interested in sending a whole group of people to hell as in welcoming them to heaven. In college, that was a time when I learned to flee quickly from the smiling person that had a little track that was called Four Spiritual Laws. And to this day, I confess, I walk by the street preacher and tend to ignore the evangelist on the subway. Next in line to those questions, brother, are we to be saved, is the smiling one who has the Bible in the hand and asks, are you born again? And neither the in-the-face tactic nor the anticipated theology sit well with me. Yet, ask in a different kind of way, and hopefully a way that can land in your spirit this morning. It's not a bad question. What is salvation? What does it mean to be saved? In this series in Lent, we are asking a whole lot of bottom line questions. We're following the book Convictions and things about faith. What is it? What's the Bible? What's salvation? What's the cross? We're looking at a number of pretty bottom line questions of the Christian faith. And today is that straightforward one. What, if anything, does salvation mean to you? Saved from? Saved to? What's it like for you these days? Need to be freed from anything? Freed from despair, or anger, or poverty, of the cash derived of the spiritual nature? Do you long to be freed from loneliness, or illness, or hatred? Longing as a community to be freed from violence, or greed, or fear, or you simply wanting to be freed from the presidential primaries? We are a society that's being whipped by fear. Fear of others, fear of failure, fear of not making the cut. What stands in your way? Do you need some liberating? Do you need to be free? And what about saved to? What are you hoping to get to? To be saved to joy, to health, to friendship, kindness? Hoping to be saved to the love of neighbor and the love of God? Or just a sense, I'd love to be saved to my life, the way it is meant to be and can be. Saved. Saved from. Saved to. Isaiah 60 is one of a host of different examples of what salvation might be about. In this case, Isaiah is writing about a nation of people. Sort of like major turning points of a country, of when we were colonies and becoming a nation. Contemporary times, this huge transformation in Germany post-World War II. What does it mean for a whole nation or people to be at a turning point on the cusp of new life? Isaiah wrote about the Jews at a turning point. They had been overrun and sent into exile by the Babylonians. No nation? Israel is now a distant memory, Judah crushed. No capital, Jerusalem in ruins. And for all practicing their faith, my God, no temple, a pile of rubble. But now, in exile, Isaiah senses something happening on the horizon. Cyrus, the Persian, is sweeping through the Middle East, and Cyrus had a respect and regard for the little people and the traditions of local clans and tribes. So Isaiah wrote these incredible words of possibility, of restoration, of coming back out of exile. Arise, shine, for your light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. It goes on to say, your son shall come from far away, your daughter shall be carried in her nurse's arms. This is all renewal. This is return back home. Jerusalem will once again be a place of wealth. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the name of the Lord. Salvation for Isaiah meant restoration and return from exile. Salvation is in this world, in this life, a political reality. It's also an individual reality. Shifting to the Gospel of John, we encounter a well-loved, often quoted, and frequently misrepresented story of Nicodemus. It includes that famous punchline, you must be born from above, or translated, you must be born again. But you know, I love this story. Nicodemus is a real dork, isn't he? I mean, Nicodemus just doesn't get it. It's hard to read this story with a straight face, because it comes out, you know, Jesus says, surely I tell you, you must be born from above, from the Spirit. Nicodemus responds, absolutely stuck in literalism, no imagination at all. Jesus, now tell me how this works. Does a person in old age crawl back into their mother's womb and be, yikes, Nick, you are stuck. It's a metaphor, Nick. Get with it, Nick. Come on. Poor Nick. To be born from above, Jesus says, is to be swept over and changed by the Spirit. Transformed. Renewed. In this life, in this world, is what Jesus is talking about. Now, as we know, quite unfortunately, this born-again phrase has taken on a whole life of itself within American culture. Many speak of it as a one-time dramatic experience of conversion. That can be, but that's not by definition. That's not what Jesus was saying. Others assume a whole list of fundamentalist assumptions, not referenced in the text at all, but nevertheless a part of our historical setting and use of language. But take note, as the story of Nicodemus clearly illustrates, to be saved can also mean personal transformation by way of the Spirit of God. Change, renewed. Now, the whole sweep of the Bible is rich with numerous examples of what salvation can mean. Those of us reading the Marcus Borg book will find a chapter with a wonderful set, quickly, of summaries. What does salvation mean in the Bible? Well, it can mean liberation from bondage, the story of the Exodus. It can mean the return from exile, what Pat read from Isaiah. Salvation can mean life to the dead, spiritually or physically dying, as in the healing stories of Jesus. Salvation means food and drink, the sustenance of life celebrated throughout the Jewish and Christian scriptures. Salvation can mean being saved from sin, as the prophets John the Baptist and Jesus called folks back to just and right lives. All of these are descriptions of what salvation means. And notice, heaven is rarely mentioned. Even though Jesus and his followers certainly trusted that the everlasting love of God was real promise to the people. A belief in the afterlife did emerge during biblical times, but it's not a very prominent theme. And Jesus spoke primarily of the kingdom of God in this life, and as we pray every week, on earth. Problem today in our culture is we've taken little pieces and put them, I think, way out of perspective. One problem in American Protestantism is to say that salvation is all about going to heaven. That's it. It's what Diana Butler Bass calls the elevator church. The purpose of church is to take an elevator ride out of this land and out of earth. Overemphasizing that becomes obvious as a problem because it can lead to a disinterest in the long-term care of creation or ignoring the abuse of the land or its peoples, believing they are of no inherent value. If the point of faith is solely and only heaven, well, then life doesn't matter. Something quite contrary to the scriptures, particularly to the prophets and Jesus. Elevator church limits the good news. But at the same time, we American Protestants have a peculiar other twist, namely that salvation means wealth and health. Formerly called the gospel of wealth in earlier decades, now simply referred to as the prosperity gospel, basically the bedrock of much of mass media religion. In this deviation of faith, salvation is seen as wealthiness. You're going to make money. It's promised in many of our churches. Promise that you will live, well, almost forever. That's a problem with the promise of wealth and health, is that we're all mortal. Viewed as absolutely bizarre by much of the rest of the Christian world, it is particularly an American form of civil religion that fills the airwaves. Now, benefits from God, life everlasting, got these. These are real. Their mention is a question of emphasis. So try this out. I'm working on a definition of salvation. To be saved is to experience the transforming presence of the Spirit of God in order to love neighbors and to love God. To be saved is to be transformed into the image of God, following Jesus, loving neighbor, loving God. Is it everlasting? Well, yes, for God is everlasting. Saved. Salvation. What does it mean for you? Let me just tell a few stories. This week, I got a check in the mail for $150 to return to the Caterly Emergency Fund. Some years back, I gave a person some money to enter into a rehab center. The goal, the hope, well, the reality was the last chance, was to clean up and start over. The remarkable thing is that it's happened. Cleaned up, this person now has a job, got a check back to return to the emergency fund. It's a story of death to life. When we walk the hills outside of Laodon in Haiti, we travel from barren, eroded land into areas of new forest and then the development of gardens. Dead land is turned into fertile soil that can sustain crops. The restoration of the land means that the people need not flee to the slums of Port-au-Prince, but can stay on the hills. It is restoration of land and lives. Salvation. I've talked with a number of your colleagues who tell me about the routine of Thursday night and Sunday morning as the opportunity to enter into beauty. And others have told me about their private practices. One person who gets up very early every morning, this surprised me, a whole hour of quiet meditation and reflection, entering into mystery and wonder. And these cases of beauty and wonder, life-giving. When, as Miss describes, I see a second grader greet his stare tutor and there's a mutual set of smiles, I can see the joy of learning, the power of caring, and the life-giving energy that time makes a difference. Salvation. Mark visited Winter Relief last week. If you read the daily updates, you would have heard about him. He was a shelter guest a year ago. This year, gainfully employed and a neighbor on Main Street. The high school girl told of being intimidated and then abused by her boyfriend. He demanded sex for her to prove her loyalty. She regained her sense of self and the dignity of her own body and left him. She's on a journey to find her life once again. Born from above, one might say. A middle-aged man spoke of a lifelong struggle to just live within his own spirit and soul. You see, for his whole life, he had never been good enough, though he thought. Could never make the cut, make the grade. That was a lifelong struggle. And in prayer, in therapy, he discovered his life. Renewed. An older man has come to peace with his advanced age and declining health. Oh, nothing particularly good to say about it. I mean, declining health just, well, it's not good news. It just happens. But this particular man said he's come to peace with God, with my life, with myself. The Spirit has allowed this to happen. Transformed by the Spirit of God, saved from, saved to. Well, buddy, have you been born again? And I would say, no, I have. Time and time again, when the Spirit and that wind that is beyond our control brushes over my life and I discover something new. Yeah, time and time again. And may, by the grace of God, it be time after precious time for you.